Good morning. Welcome, everybody, to the fifth meeting of the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2022. Before we move to consideration of the petitions before us, I would like to say that today is the second anniversary of the first COVID-19 lockdown and is also a national day of reflection. As the presiding officer has said, this global pandemic has taken so much from so many. Parliament stands shoulder to shoulder with all those who have suffered, all those grieving loved ones, and those whose lives have been changed forever. Throughout the pandemic, we've seen communities respond with care, with understanding, and this should give us all hope for the future. And accordingly, we will be pausing later this morning at 12 noon to join in the minute's silence. So just to pre-warn that that could come at any point in our proceedings, depending on the progress we are currently making. Our first item this morning is consideration of continued petitions with an evidence session on petition number 1812, which is to protect Scotland's remaining ancient, native and semi-native woodlands and woodland floors. This petition was lodged by Audrey Baird and Fiona Baker on behalf of Help Trees Help Us, who, of course, we heard from in an evidence session a fortnight or so ago. The first of the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to deliver world-leading legislation giving Scotland's remaining fragments of ancient, native and semi-native woodlands and woodland floors full legal protection before COP26, as the petition was then lodged. Our last consideration was on the 9th of March, when we took evidence, as I say, from the petitioners and from a list of range of interested organisations. And today we will be taking evidence from Mary McCallan, who's the Minister for Environment and Land Reform. Welcome. Nice to have you with us. And the Minister is joined. I very often give you one of our honorary season tickets by Doug Howison, the Interim Head of Operational Delivery at Scottish Forestry, who, of course, participated in the round table a fortnight ago. Also joining us remotely this morning, sadly unable to join us at the round table a fortnight ago, but with us today is Jackie Bailey. And Jackie, I will invite you to come in to give some comment later when we have heard what the witnesses have had to say. Can we just go straight into questions then, I think, because the round table was actually fascinating. I think lots of themes came forward. There was a lot of commonality. I think there were some areas that the committee had not considered quite so much in our earlier review, because the petitioners had at that stage submitted quite a comprehensive portfolio of photographs which particularly illustrated the effect of invasive species in our native woodland. So, Minister, in the most recent progress report in Scotland's route map to 2020, the targets for native woodland were identified as areas where insufficient progress has been made. So I think this was the sort of area that people wondered what the Scottish Government was now doing to sort of enhance those efforts in that particular area.
Thanks very much, Convener, and it's good to be with you all today on what is a really important topic, reflected, I think, in the signatures and the signatories to the petition, but I share the importance with which it's viewed. Just on your question, I would probably split that into two parts. Firstly, as regards our efforts on new woodland creation and the native component of that. And secondly, the actions that we're taking to try and protect, restore and grow the remaining ancient, natural, semi-natural woodland. So first of all, on woodland creation, our objective in the Scottish Government is to manage our woodlands for the number of co-benefits that they can provide for the country. Now, that spans across economic opportunities, environmental opportunities, obviously, but also social opportunities. And our challenge is to, as I say, manage their creation in a way that reflects all of those things. So we have targets for creation, which are very ambitious, which reflect our ambitious climate change targets. But we have targets within that. So, for example, we have a target that 3,000 hectares, as a minimum, of all woodland planted in Scotland should be native broadleaved. And we have been meeting and exceeding that target and therefore have taken action to increase it. We've moved that floor from a minimum of 3,000 to a minimum of 4,000. We've also committed in our biodiversity strategy, which is currently being worked on, to look again at that target, to take an evidence-based look at it, to see if it could be more ambitious still. And we also do other activities to try and protect those efforts. For example, the Forestry Grant Scheme has supported 12,000 hectares of native planting in the last 3 years. But that's about new efforts to create. And if we think about... Yeah, of course.
Because it's quite interesting. I mean, obviously, one of the things the petitioners were concerned about was with the new forest planting, the native content. Mm-hmm. And that's interesting to hear the government seeking to increase the percentage of that within it. What is the balancing act in all of that? I mean, to understand, or for people to understand, why is it not all native? I mean, what is the calculation that is made in trying to determine the percentage of that that can be native species as opposed to not?
It's a really excellent question and something which myself and officials grapple with all the time. The basis of it is that we're in a very fortunate position that woodland can deliver across many objectives. It can deliver on carbon sequestration, it can deliver on biodiversity growth, and it can deliver on socioeconomic outcomes like good job creation in rural areas. And the types of woodlands we create have to be balanced across that. So, for example, we need to plant fast-growing commercial species because they have the greatest opportunity for carbon sequestration. They also allow us to prop up a really successful timber industry, which, of course, for we will all know, supports a lot of jobs in rural Scotland. Then there are types of trees which support our biodiversity objectives, native broadleaf trees that will help us to reverse a decline in biodiversity in Scotland. And there are other objectives that we build into that picture. So, for example, there's a requirement of 10% open space in new woodland creation. And that's about serving a socio-economic objective of supporting well-being so that people can spend time in forests enjoying the health and well-being aspects that come with that. So it's almost you start from a position where woodland can deliver and we have to take a judgment on how best to match those objectives with the types of trees we grow, with the types of forests that we develop. And all of that is underpinned by the UK Forestry Standard, which is about all of those things, and it's about managing forests for their multiple value.
Thank you. That's right. I interrupted you, but thank you. That was very helpful clarification.
No, that's fine. Do you want me to talk a little bit about...
Yes, please do. Just...
Yeah, so that was very much on new woodland creation. If we think about those which are already existing, and I've thought very hard about this before and even more so before coming in today, and the way I see it is there are a complex, I would admit, set of rules and regulations which determine the protection of ancient woodlands, native woodlands. For example, we have a system of triple SIs where native and ancient woodlands of a particular size or antiquity will be protected by these environmental designations. And if something, for example, were to be applied to be felled within a triple SI, it would have to come to with a felling permission or a triple SI consent. The Forestry and Land Management Act, which we strengthened in 2018, also provides for the potential management felling of these woodlands. And again, it means that anything between 0.1 and 0.5 hectares would have to go to a felling permission. So both of these routes take us to this felling permission. And you might ask yourself then, well, in what circumstances would felling be allowed with our ancient woodlands? Well, ultimately, there are very few circumstances in which felling of any ancient woodland would be approved. It's almost the strongest possible terms that the regulations can provide that without a total ban. And you can understand why there isn't a total ban when you see what are the exceptional circumstances where it might be approved. And that might be, for example, and Doug, you can correct me if I'm wrong here, but something which would be about breaking up the canopy of the forest to allow light in, to support the woodland floor and to support the growth of the ancient woodlands. It might also be about removing invasive non-native species. So as I see it, a very robust, albeit complex, web of protections, which when they are operating correctly, should absolutely protect our ancient woodlands. Of course, there are threats. There are threats we'll come on to this, I'm sure, but in overgrazing, invasive non-native species, climate change generally is a threat. So I'll pause there, but I think we can come on to how the government's trying to rise to some of those challenges later on.
Yeah, and some of those themes will emerge. You said when they are working, and I suppose that one of the questions of the petitioners was, do they? Mm-hmm. And are they applied? And they saw very much the forthcoming Natural Environment Bill, also the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, as opportunities for there to be more or further protection through legislative routes. And I suppose the question really is whether that is envisaged at all, or whether in preparing for these initiatives, as you've said, there are regulations and opportunities, if things are applied and work well within the current framework, that could be improved so that they do. And I suppose, so the question is what's there, is there an evidence trail to show that what's there has been doing the job it was meant to do? And if not, is there something more that might be contemplated, or that the government might be considering contemplating?
Yes. So I think whilst I remain open-minded to all and any suggestions as to how we strengthen, improve, rise to emerging challenges as regards the protection of our ancient woodlands, I think that the system as it stands, that environmental designation that I mentioned, the forestry and land management route, we're operating correctly. They ought to be sufficient. Now, there are a whole series of things that, you know, we're not complacent. The government is trying to identify all threats, frankly, to these incredibly precious trees and woodlands. And we're taking action across the board. So one of the things I'm particularly pleased to see, and if I can just find the quote on this, is the development of MPF4 and some of the provisions within that for protecting our woodlands, because this is some of the very explicit planning laws that will determine what happens throughout Scotland. And the draft, as it currently is being consulted on, says development proposals should not be supported where they would result in any loss of ancient woodlands, ancient and veteran trees, or adverse impact on their ecological condition, or adverse impacts on native woodlands, hedgerows, and individual trees of high biodiversity value. So my overriding feeling is that when it comes to the potential felling or removal, that there are a suite of rules in place which ought to protect them. We have enforcement powers where Scottish Forestry have enforcement powers where that's not occurring. They were strengthened in 2018 to mean that, for example, we wouldn't need a successful prosecution in order to move to restocking, and indeed that Scottish Forestry can step in and undertake that restocking. So where that's operating, it ought to protect them, but we are always looking for new ways to do that through MPF4 and again through deer work and invasive non-native species, which again we can come on to.
Thank you. That's very helpful. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister.
Morning.
An evidence session 2 weeks ago, I asked a question about MPF4 and how it would help protect ancient woodlands. And can I just quote from one of the answers I was given from one of the witnesses? National Planning Framework 4 is a tremendous opportunity that we must not lose. We cannot afford to take a risk to have weak legislation to create loopholes. In the evidence session we were given, they did not think the language was strong enough in MPF4 to allow planners to make recommendations that our law would be able to back them.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that's the case? And if it is the case, will you change that?
Thanks, it's a really good question. And I am taking an active role in development of MPF4 insofar as I can within the government to make sure that a whole range of objectives in the environment portfolio are going to be facilitated through it. And the protection of our woodlands is, of course, one of them. So I said previously that I think the legal landscape is complicated, but I don't think it's vague, and I don't think that it is ineffective. I think it's complicated. Now, there are good reasons why, for example, you won't find currently in law a ban on the removal of certain trees and woodlands, because of those examples that I mentioned where you might need to do works in order to support the woodlands conservation as a whole. And when it comes to planning documents, I mean, I think that we need them to be direct and explicit, but we also need them to apply, to be able to be applied right across the country. So the narrower you get in your language, the more difficult it becomes to be a planning document. Having said that, I mean, I read what NPF4, as it is currently being consulted on, says, and I'll just repeat it. Development proposals should not be supported where they would result in any loss of ancient woodland, which I think actually is very pointed for a planning document. And I'm pleased to see it. But of course, I'm working with stakeholders, and where they think language needs to be strengthened, I'm going to be an advocate for that. But I think MPF4 as it stands is clear and pretty unequivocal. And I think that with that, we now need to look at all the other pressures that are bearing down on our antique woodlands, including deer, including invasive non-native species, including climate change, wildfires. And I am happy and comfortable that across the piece we're trying to rise to those challenges as well. But of course, MPF4 is still in draft and still a bit of a moving document.
Thank you, Minister. In the evidence session 2 weeks ago, it was a lack of data on where ancient woodlands were. The Scottish Government's committed to a National Register of Ancient Woodlands. Can you update us where that is, and can that be used? And I'm talking about local authorities here and planners. If they don't know where an ancient woodland is, how can they protect it? So will that document be created fast so that local authorities and planners can actually have a register of where ancient woodlands are and be able to protect them?
Yeah, no, I think you're absolutely right. It's one of the first points in anything is identifying the location, the status, the conservation status, the threats on it. So, yes, this is in our programme for government to develop the Register of Ancient Woodlands. We are taking forward the development of that through the summer, and it will be a parallel exercise with the biodiversity strategy. There are a number of existing registers or archives of where the ancient woodlands and the native and natural and semi-natural woodlands are. But I think bringing them together is a really important exercise for the reasons you say, so that local authorities and all of those who've got a responsibility for looking after them know exactly where they are. But I think also for landowners, so that we can know where ancient woodlands exist. I would like to see that down to really very small pockets, because everything requires to be conserved. And we can use that to support and encourage and incentivise landowners even more than we already do to support them. So in the summer, I hope to see that being developed.
Thank you, Minister. No further questions.
Thank you.
Doug, did you want to
come in? We're very happy to hear from you again, because obviously you contributed to our discussion a fortnight ago. Would you like to come in on any of the points we've touched on so far?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to help provide some evidence for that answer. So the Planning Act in 2019 placed the requirement on local authorities to create a forest woodland strategy. National MPF4 emphasised the need through local development plans for local authorities to develop forest woodland strategies. Now, in those forest woodland strategies, they also identify ancient, semi-natural and native woodland. And Nature Scot and Scottish Forestry are consulted on the establishment of those forest woodland strategies. So that process, which the Minister has been encouraging us to do helps to drill further into the identification of those native insects in natural woodlands and to ensure that they therefore get additional protection through the creation of forest woodland strategies connected to local development plans where they don't already exist. So I think there are some good things that are being taken forward through MPF4 that will help with that.
Thank you for that. Could I just ask, are the local authorities up to date on that and planning? Because if they haven't done what you've just said, planners are just going to say yes, no, as you know, in the decision. How does the government check that they have managed to do that?
Well, is it okay to answer, Minister? So we have very close relationships with all local authorities in Scotland, and they are statutory consultees for Scottish Forestry and Nature Scot for all developments of the type that we've been discussing. So we're certain that that requirement that the local authorities are aware of the need for that. The second thing to say is that Native Woodland Survey of Scotland is available on the Scottish Forestry map browser, and the local authority colleagues who generally employ forestry specialists are aware of the need for this and are aware of the need to drive that forward. So I think there's only about two or three local authorities remaining in Scotland who haven't prepared a forest and woodland strategy, and they are undertaking that task now.
Thank you.
Thank you. One of our committee, Paul Sweeney, is joining us remotely this morning. Paul Sweeney.
Convener, interesting introduction. The Woodlands Trust, it was identified in the previous evidence session, the Woodland Trust had already done an exercise to investigate the extent of ancient woodland in Scotland and had identified that it amounts to about 5 hectares in total. Could the government give a commitment to undertake that all of that is protected under a SSSI as quickly as possible?
Thanks for the question. I'm not going to make a commitment like that in this forum because I am not a scientist who would, or an ecologist who would be tasked with considering the characteristics of woodlands throughout Scotland and determining whether they ought to be protected under SSSI or a special area of conservation. So as a government minister, I'm not going to preempt the views of scientists and ecologists in that regard. But what I can commit to doing is ensuring and being open-minded to all suggestions as to how we can strengthen the protection of them as they stand, and also how we can rise to all of the challenges that are bearing down on them as they are just now, which I have listed, but I mean, I would quite like to go into a little bit more detail on, because, for example, deer pressure is roundly and across the piece accepted as being one of the single greatest threats to the ancient woodlands. And it's been described really well to me as, for example, if you look across the piece, we have ancient antique trees, but because of activity on the ground over tens, decades and centuries where grazing has increased, the saplings that tree has tried to produce have been consumed. And it's described as that leaves the grand parent tree and all of the rest of the family have not managed to establish because of the over-browsing by deer. So that is critical for us in trying to protect and grow them. But so is invasive non-native species clearance. We're investing heavily in that. So is combating wildfire, which is a threat to our woodlands. I'm going to be taking a separate piece of legislation through the Parliament on grouse moor licensing, in which I will also consider the licensing of moor burn, because you can imagine that a wildfire ripping through our countryside, particularly as we're due to have warmer summers, is an immediate threat. Mr. Sweeney, I will not commit to the SSSI point just now. It wouldn't be appropriate for me to do so, but I will commit to doing everything I can to protect these precious trees and woodlands.
Thanks. I should just clarify, it was the Woodland Trust investigated that most ancient woodland pockets are less than 5 hectares in size, so they're quite isolated fragments, if you know what I mean, not rather than it being a cumulative coverage of Scotland. Thanks for that. It was a particular case about enforcement of tree protection orders that was raised by two of the witnesses or the petitioners, and they cited a case in Argyll that was particularly problematic, where there are penalties for tree felling. I think it's £5,000 per tree. But what actually happened was, in this instance, the enforcement of it has been delayed. The Argyll and Bute Council haven't enforced the tree protection order in a timely manner, therefore permitting the landlord to clear it for grazing without any adequate enforcement. And also understand that the National Authority, I think it's Scottish Forestry, I'm just trying to find the right section of the transcription. Bear with me a second. Yeah, so they said that they have heard that there won't be any enforcement at a national level by the forestry officer. They've basically came to a gentleman's agreement on the issue. So that raises a concern about the extent to which vandalism of ancient woodland effectively is enforced, even where there are protections. Would you agree that there are issues there that need further investigation?
Thanks for the question. And just very briefly on just to pick up again on the last point about the hectareage, it's a good point that you and the Woodland Trust make about 0.5 hectares. However, the Forestry and Land Management Act was strengthened in 2018 to cover woodlands of less than 0.5 hectares. So I think Doug will correct me if I'm wrong, but it's 0.1 hectares up to 0.5 now require a felling permission. And as I say, there are very few circumstances in which ancient woodlands would be felled or would be afforded a felling permission. Just on the point about enforcement, which is, it's really important. I know from this role, but also in constituency capacity, that there are concerns, you know, frequent concerns, I would say, that felling is undertaken without regard to the rules and occasionally without concern for the enforcement actions that might be taken as a result of that. So for our part, we have rules which it's a criminal offence. It can be can result in a fine of up to £5,000. We have, as I say, we strengthened the rules in 2018 to allow Scottish Forestry to not require a successful prosecution in order to install a restocking directive. Forestry Scotland can have a step-in responsibility where they can undertake it where it's not being undertaken by the landowner. But despite all of that, I understand the frustration where people might see things going on not in line with the rules. Doug and I and our teams, we try to respond proactively to these cases when they are raised with us. We'll investigate the circumstances. And I do remain open-minded to any ways that we can make sure that they are being complied with across the board.
Thanks very much for that. An interesting theme arose in the discussion with the petitioners at the last session when we sort of discussed potential comparators of what they would like to see as a framework, if you like, for protections for ancient woodland. And a comparator arose about the listed buildings programme and also for scheduled ancient monuments as a basis for considering how a new scheme of protection could be brought in, rather than just it simply being a triple SI, which might require quite a significant burden of evidence about, you know, particular horticulture or scientifically and biologically significant characteristics. So effectively, it could be simply that the amenity of this forestry is important to the community. It could be that it is known as an ancient woodland that is, you know, native species that would merit protection on that basis rather than any further requirements. Is it potentially an opportunity to consider something akin to the Scheduled Ancient Monuments Programme or the Listed Buildings Programme, where communities can actually nominate areas of woodland that they want protected to be considered? And also, obviously, when the listing system and the protections for built heritage were introduced in the 1960s, it required a total sort of national survey done by the Royal Commission to identify the national list of protected sites. So perhaps a similar basis could be undertaken for woodlands in this instance, given the scale of the kind of national pressure. that's been faced, perhaps that could be an interesting benchmark to look at in how we approach this going forward.
Thanks very much for that. I think just a couple of points from me, and then I'll probably hand over to Doug, who can maybe give a more technical overview of the existing rules and the extent to which they might already be akin to something like what Mr. Sweeney is asking for. But first of all, you mentioned the community point and almost the ability to nominate woodlands that folks would like to see protected. I am very enthusiastic about community involvement in the ownership, management, co-development of woodlands, not least because I believe that, you know, any kind of development happening on people's doorsteps ought to involve them and they ought to benefit from it. But also, I think as we move in the next 20, 25 years towards our net zero targets, Scotland's land, the way we use it, is going to change, and I want to see communities benefit from that. So I'm always mindful of how I can build in, with working with officials, greater community engagement, greater ownership, greater development. And on the point about to what extent what we have already is akin to something like Schedule of Ancient Monuments, I might hand over to Doug, because I suspect that it might be similar, but dealt with differently through some of these schemes that we've been talking about already.
Yeah, thank you. So, thank you, Minister. So, there's a couple of things there. The Minister has said that there's a commitment to a new register of ancient woodland that will be taken forward or start to develop later in the summer. The last survey of ancient woodland dates back to the 70s by the Joint Nature Conservancy Council. And so this is a good opportunity to revisit with improved technology the distribution of ancient woodland, specifically as opposed to native woodland in Scotland, and to be able, therefore, to provide a benchmark for further protection going forward from that point. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that where sites are designated either as a SSSI or an SAC, a special area of conservation or a special protection area, they are afforded control or protection from Nature Scot. And their consent is required for operations within those woodlands that could cause damage to or develop or protect those woodlands. And that's very much akin to some of the protections that come from scheduled ancient monuments and so on and so forth. So there are existing parallels within the regulatory system that afford similar protections, Mr. Sweeney. So I'm quite happy that that is afforded. And then secondly, where sites aren't designated, they require a felling permission. And as the Minister has said, it's very rarely that a felling permission would be provided on an ancient woodland, save for specific requirements to protect, enhance and develop that ancient woodland. So we are of the opinion that the protection we've got in place currently provide for what you're asking for, sir.
Thank you. I'm keen to bring in other committee members now. Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Want to welcome the comments you made about community ownership and development. I think that's really important, and it came across from the petitioners that they'd felt pretty disenfranchised by some of the some of what had gone on. So I think it's really good to hear you champion that community involvement. I wonder if I can go back a bit and just ask a little bit more about the threats. And we've heard from yourself and from stakeholders that so the biggest threats. Deer, one of the issues, and also non-native species. Can you say a little bit more about what progress the government's making in terms of modernising the deer management legislation, and then also what the Scottish government's doing, working with landowners, I suppose, to prevent the spread of the non-native species into woodland, please?
Yes, of course. Thank you very much. So, yes, these are, I would say, the two greatest threats that are currently facing our woodlands in Scotland. Firstly, as regards deer, just come back to that analogy about the grandparent standing alone in the forest, which I think really brings it to life. We need to do something to allow that natural process of regeneration, which our ancient woodlands are so well placed to deliver, to flourish. And so we have the government received the recommendations of the Deer Working Group, and we responded to that last year. We were able to commit to implementing the vast majority of the recommendations, save one, I think, which was about the closed season for female deer, which we will not support on the basis of welfare concerns. But we intend to take forward there are non-legislative actions that we can take, and there are actions that will require primary legislation. We will take forward the non-legislative ones now through the biodiversity strategy, and then we will have the Natural Environment Bill later in this term, which I expect, although I'm not leading on that bill, but I expect it will contain any of the legislative actions that we need, that need primary legislation, but very much a focus for this parliamentary term. And then as regards invasive non-native species, this is, like deer actually, one of those things that's laborious and requires, you know, boots on the ground for really quite hard work in order to clear rhododendron, largely is, which if you travel, I was in the West Highlands recently and I just saw it, you know, consuming the forest floor. So our forestry grant scheme already supports landowners with funds to help clear rhododendron. We are working with the Atlantic Rainforest Alliance as part of our commitment to protect and restore Scotland's rainforest. And we are backing that up with some of the funds from our £500 million investment in the natural economy. And indeed, we have opened a nature restoration fund, which I can't remember the figure. I think it's 60 million multi-annual fund. And I think there's 12.5 million available this year. There are bids in for that, which are currently being considered by Nature Scot just now. And I would expect some of that to rise to the challenges of invasive non-native species. But they will be confirmed in the spring. Thank you. That's helpful.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you've talked about the management and the protection. And I think they are vital, and some of the answers you've given this morning, you've gone into some of the detail. But can I talk about the sort of implementation that we have when a number of policies that fall into place? Because, you know, the whole idea about protecting these woodlands is to ensure that they are sustainable and they continue. And resources were touched on when we had the round table about what was being spent and how it was being managed. And that has an implication as to what can be achieved, but also there's a knowledge and there's the enforcement, and you've touched on some of the enforcement issues today, but resource has a massive impact as to what you can achieve in the short to medium term. So can I ask what the Scottish Government are doing to enhance some of that, and how you're tackling that situation? Because, as I say, without the financial resource to manage it, it becomes unsustainable.
I think it's a really interesting point, and I think it applies here as it does across the piece on so many of the actions that we need to take when faced with a climate and nature emergency. The magnitude of the task for us over the next generation and more is enormous, be it in the natural environment and the funds that it takes here to do what we need to do, but be it in homes and buildings, decarbonisation, transport, the costs are eye-watering. And the public sector cannot support it ourselves. So we need to find ways of leveraging responsible private investment. I think that is a big factor of the resourcing question, because, as I say, we can't do it ourselves. I'm very keen from, you know, bringing back to that point about community empowerment and community benefit, I'm really keen to make sure that private investment is responsible private investment. But nonetheless, it has to be leveraged, and we can do that, I think, through carbon markets, and that applies to woodlands as it does to peatland restoration, which of course is a really important action, but also very expensive. So we are trying in the government to provide funding, for example, if I can just move to a different subject, peatland restoration. We're trying to provide funding which will bring confidence into the market, which will allow others to come in and support it. And that that applies across the piece.
And the sort of existing policies that the government have already advanced, are many of those now at the stage that they need to be reassessed because the time scale that's taken, and as I say, you've talked about resource, so to make things happen, there needs to be maybe a refresh as to what can be achieved, because the situation year on year becomes worse, and the amount that's required and the resource, the staffing, the implementation, and some of the policies that you put in place are just not fit for purpose in today's society and in today's market when we're looking at how we can manage the woodland, because it has seen an erosion of that, and these policies might have had an impact on that.
Yes, I think you're quite right, and it's another aspect of the fact that we're dealing with an emergency here, that we can never stop and just pat ourselves on the back and say, okay, well, that was good a year ago, so it's acceptable now. That won't be the case right up to 2045, and it won't be the case beyond 2045. So we do need to keep reviewing what we're doing, and I think a good example of that might be what I talked about at the beginning of the session, which was our targets for the percentage of our planting which must be native. So I mentioned that we had the 3,000 hectare minimum. We were meeting and exceeding that, so we've raised the minimum. And now, as part of our biodiversity strategy, we will do an evidence-based assessment of that and see if it needs to be upped again. So always trying to challenge ourselves to make sure that what we're doing is up to speed. And if we're not sufficiently challenging ourselves, then the stakeholders that we work with, Parliament, will challenge us as well. And I think all the better, because we don't have time to mess about.
And, you know, the partnership working that's already taking place in some areas has been quite pioneering. But that is not the case across the piece. Scotland doesn't have that opportunity at the moment. As I say, some locations are working well, but others have a long way to go to catch up. Do you feel that some communities are being left behind?
Yes, I think they probably are. And I think we probably all have experience in our MSP capacities of feeling that across the areas we represent, there are communities which are exceptionally active and able to advocate on their own behalf and get organised, and there are others who aren't. And I think that disparity is something that we all need to try and address. But, you know, for example, last week I visited Loch Arkaig with the Woodland Trust for Scotland and with the local community development group who are undertaking a joint venture for the restoration of Loch Arkaig. And it was a prime example of what you talked about there, which is the communities who are really organised and doing exceptionally well. But you're also right to say that there are others who are less well organised, not for the want of trying, I suspect. And I think that I mentioned I'm really keen to make sure that communities are supported. It's something that I take very seriously. And there probably is a lesson here for us in, you know, how accessible a lot of this is. I talked about that complex network of rules which I'm comfortable protect the woodlands, but are they accessible? Well, that's a different question. And the work we're trying to do on the registered, etc., should help open this up and make it something that everyone can be involved with.
Thank you, Convener.
Minister, I mean, you made reference to all the things that you would potentially like to do and the enormous resource on the public purse that represents. One of the things the petitioners looked at or were seeking to encourage was incentives to be provided to landowners to protect natural woodlands on their land. Is that one of those things that falls into the desirable but maybe hard to achieve categories, or is it something that there is potentially room to accommodate?
So we're already accommodating it through our forestry grant scheme, which Doug will have more of the details of at his fingertips, but it already supports landowners with funding to undertake management of their woodlands for conservation purposes as well as for other purposes. And, you know, we have opportunities coming down the track to look again at how well we're doing this. For example, we have the design of post-EU exit agricultural policy, And we have, I'll be taking a land reform bill through the Parliament this term, I hope to anyway. And in all of these ways, we can be assessing both the incentives and the requirements that are available to landowners. And speaking of the land reform portfolio, of course, a big part of that is the Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement, which makes clear that with rights comes responsibilities. And I think in an emergency, landowners and their rights and responsibilities, you know, perhaps we could do more to make clear our expectations about how land is managed.
Okay, thank you. Quickly, Mr. Sweeney, you want to come in, and then I'm going to invite Jackie Bailey to make a statement to the committee based on the consideration that we've heard this morning. Mr. Sweeney?
Yeah, it was just a quick one on a point that was raised in the last session, evidence session, about since 1999, 270 woodlands have been lost or damaged by development, which is significantly higher than other parts of the UK. Obviously, Scotland has perhaps more forestry coverage per hectare. But like, what I would like to understand is, has there lessons learned exercise been undertaken to understand why those 270 ancient woodlands were lost, and what can be done to sort of arrest the cause of that? And also, understand it was raised at the last session that one of the biggest threats is basically coniferous seeding and contamination that leads to basically impinging on ancient woodland sites. But the forestry industry is exempt from the UK forestry standard on contamination and monitoring and addressing contamination. Do we need to do more to actually put obligations on the forestry industry to prevent that contamination from conifer plantations?
Thanks, Mr. Sweeney. Two important questions. Technical questions, and which I will try to give an answer to, although I would prefer to be able to go away and get you a fuller answer. But I'll also, you know, ask my colleague Doug if there's anything he should like to add. But we will seek to come back to you with a response to those which are detailed enough to reflect the detail of the question. But just if I can pick up very quickly on the point about the contamination almost of different species of trees and the extent to which that is a threat to our ancient woodlands. For our part, Forestry and Land Scotland, who manage the public forests and estate on behalf of Scottish ministers, to the extent to which there has been a historic planting on any ancient woodland sites that they manage, they are undertaking restoration in 60% of those sites. And what that often means is removing the non-native or non-natural species that are planted in and around the ancient woodland site to prevent that cross-contamination of species and to allow the ancient woodlands to develop as they naturally would. But having said that, I'll pass over to Doug, and we will both come back to you separately with some more detail on your questions.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Minister. So, Mr. Sweeney, I think the loss that you refer to is a result of deer, invasive non-native species, and the seeding in of conifer trees, which are also invasive non-native species. So that's how we understand and articulate the loss of those, as opposed to the built environment being placed upon ancient woodlands. So that's the first thing. In terms of lessons learned, yeah, I think there is. I think some of the things that have been proposed in MPF4 are as a direct result of that, and the policy number 34 for ancient woodland is a good example of that. And secondly, I think as the biodiversity strategy is released later in the year, I think there would be some evidence from that as those lessons learned, and there's a statement of intent within the biodiversity strategy to bring that forward. And then thirdly, Scottish Forestry, Forest and Land Scotland and Nature Scot are working with the Alliance for Scotland's Rainforests in order to pull the resources as best we can to reverse some of the decline that you've eloquently referred to in your question, Mr. Sweeney. So I think there are things there that we're doing to understand that decline and to learn from that and to start to reverse it.
To that, convener, I would just add that in the Natural Environment Bill that we'll be hoping to bring through Parliament, we'll expect to bring forward statutory targets for nature recovery and nature growth, akin to the climate targets, which I think we would all agree have been a turning point for action on emissions reduction. And within that, we're also committed to protecting 30% of our land for nature by 2030. And in both of those pieces of work, albeit I'm not leading on them, that will be my colleague, Ms Slater, I will be arguing very strongly for the inclusion of the greatest possible protection for our ancient woodlands within those projects.
Thank you very much, Minister. Thank you, Mr Howison. And listening to proceedings with us this morning has been Jackie Bailey, who has supported the petitioners in the development of this petition. Jackie Bailey, would you like to offer a further statement to the committee that we can consider along with the evidence we've heard this morning?
Indeed, Convener, and thank you very much for the time afforded to me at the committee, and my apologies that I couldn't be with you when you last considered the petition. I wonder whether I might also ask some questions of the Minister, because, you know, to be frank, I don't doubt the Minister's good intentions, but I think the issue here is that they are at odds with the petitioner's direct experience. And let me acknowledge that the Minister's language was very careful, because I think she herself recognises that there is scope for improvement. I believe at the heart of this is the difference between what existing legislation and guidance may say and the reality of its implementation on the ground. So let me be candid. People are not seeking permission to fell ancient woodland. They're just doing it. Reports are made to Scottish Forestry and enforcement action is not taken. Reports are indeed made to councils. They're asked to put in place TROs. That's not yet been done a year on. So does the Minister perhaps accept, and perhaps she'll answer all my questions at the end, that all of this demonstrates that the existing framework is insufficient in terms of its practical implementation? And there is a sense of urgency here. So, you know, I hear what the Minister and her official have been saying about what's coming, NPF4, the biodiversity strategy, the work that's ongoing. But there is a sense of urgency here that I'm not sure is fully appreciated, because we are losing ancient woodland. There's very little of it left to start with, and we are losing it at pace. So I'm genuinely concerned about the timescale for this, and I would therefore urge perhaps immediate action that can be taken now whilst we're waiting for all the things coming down the track. Can I say I very much welcome the Register of Ancient Woodlands. I think nobody would dispute that. I hear it starting in the summer. What I didn't hear from the Minister was when it's going to be completed, which of course is the key issue. The committee was shown, and I'm sure the Minister has seen, the images of non-native species such as conifers invading and effectively destroying ancient woodlands. You spoke about investing in removal. Just yesterday, the Scottish Wild Land Group reported of their concerns about the Highlands in particular and modern commercial forestry practice. And this is what they had to say. There is also the ever-increasing problem of non-native conifers, particularly Sitka spruce, seeding out of these plantations and beginning a takeover of the wider landscape. If no action is taken in 100 years or so, the hills will no longer be open moorland, but transformed into spruce forest. So we've heard about New Zealand removing non-native conifers where they've seeded in ancient woodlands and elsewhere. You spoke about investing in removal. What is the scale and pace of this? Because my fear is there's simply insufficient being done. And finally, but perhaps most importantly for me, is the impact on local communities. These are tax haven companies, such as Gresham House, who are taking advantage of the tree planting programmes encouraged by the government in Scotland. They are about tax avoidance funds for wealthy clients. They're not about preserving the environment. These companies outbid local communities for land. Farmers are concerned about the loss of productive land. Haulage lorries thundering through small roads in tiny villages, their concerns are simply swept aside. So I was really encouraged to hear the Minister's comments about ownership, management and co-development. These are absolutely the right sentiments, but I need to know what practically is going to happen. There was no mention of that in any legislation. Will you give communities the right to buy as a first off before any of these companies come in? So these are the practical things that potentially would make a difference. Convener, let me conclude by saying that I think everybody, without fail, agrees that ancient woodlands are particularly important for Scotland. They contribute to our biodiversity. Nobody disagrees with any of that. What is clear to me is that there is a need for much more robust action to match the ministers and the government's good intentions, so that we actually see that on the ground. That's not just legislation and guidance, that's also about enforcement action. So I'm grateful to the committee for considering this petition, and indeed for the minister for taking the time to respond today.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bailey. I don't think it would be quite right for members of the Parliament who are not members of the committee to cross-examine the minister as such. But I will, in asking the minister if there's anything she would finally like to say to the committee just before we draw the session to a conclusion, we'd be very pleased to hear what that was.
Of course. Convener, thank you. And I'll use that opportunity, if you don't mind, just to respond to Ms Bailey's points, all of which I note and I think are helpful. First of all, she asked about some specifics. I'll start with the community engagement point. I have been in post now for approaching a year, which I can scarcely believe. And in that time, I have tried to take the portfolio and stress the community element of it. So officials and I have been working with the Scottish Land Commission to understand exactly how best we can embed community engagement, development, management, ownership within our ambitions for Woodlands. And of course, I'm hoping to take forward a land reform bill in this term, which, as well as continuing Scotland's land reform journey, I will be trying to rise specifically to the challenge of what is colloquially termed green lairds, which I think is a issue we're all conscious of as the value of Scotland's natural capital rises in the climate emergency. Ms Bailey, you asked about what action is currently being taken on clearing the ancient woodlands, which are potentially planted with other species. Well, I'm not sure if I said this before, but just let me confirm that FLS, who manage land on behalf of the Scottish ministers, are currently undertaking restoration of 60% of the what we call the pause sites, which are the plantations on ancient woodland sites. So 60%, and I'll expect that to increase as we can. And then the point that you made about the forestry grant scheme and the extent to which it's supporting those who could readily afford to undertake work. In any case, well, the forestry grant scheme has in recent years, I think 60%, although I will correct that if I'm wrong, 60% of all grants have been for projects of less than 20 hectares. And we have a real focus on working with farmers, for example, to help them to stitch woodland into their farming business. So there is a focus on the smaller players as well, although right tree, right place for the right reason is our mantra in the support that we offer. And just finally, on the point about the extent to which everything that we have discussed today and what the government's doing feels at odds with what communities are experiencing, I understand that point because, as I said, I have experience in my own constituency capacity of that occasionally being the case. What I see in this role is the national picture. And when looking at the national picture, I am comfortable that the rules as they are robust. However, as with anything, there are circumstances where people will not comply with the rules. Now, very frequently when that happens, people will get in touch with me, they will get in touch with Forestry Scotland, and we try to actively get involved, often visiting sites to see what is happening and what we can do to help. And Doug and I discussed this before coming today, and we would like to offer Doug or Nature Scot officials or indeed a local conservancy officer to visit with Jackie Bailey and with constituents to any sites that they would like us to come and see what has potentially gone wrong in that circumstance.
Thank you very much, Minister. Thank you very much both to you and to Mr. Harrison for your time this morning. That's been an incredibly helpful discussion. Will the committee members agree that we'll consider the evidence we've heard this morning at a subsequent meeting? You are content with that? Thank you. In which case, I'll just have a short suspension to allow everyone to regroup. But again, thank you very, very much. Thank you. Welcome back to further consideration of continued petitions. Our next petition is petition number 1905, a public inquiry into the response of religious organisations to allegations of child sex abuse since 1950, lodged by Angela Cousins on behalf of the UK XJW Support. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to order a public inquiry into the actions taken by religious organisations in response to child sex abuse allegations since 1950. Today we will be taking evidence from our petitioner, Angela Rosina Cousins. I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to Angela, and on behalf of the committee, I'd like to thank her for coming to speak to us about something really which is obviously very personal to her, I imagine difficult to talk about, and we very much appreciate the fact that you are taking the time to come and speak with us this morning. And I know from the consideration of the petition that we've had before, you know, that the Scottish Government's view has been that to extend the public inquiry would in some way undermine the ability for it to make progress in the short term when other parts of the country are perhaps taking a different point of view. But I'm going to move straight into questions, and I think just by way of a kind of understanding for our discussion, to explain a bit about your own background, what led to the petition, and the issues which, you know, you have been raising in relation to child abuse and religious organisations.
Yeah, sure. So I was raised as a Jehovah's Witness from very early ages. Being that I was a baby when my parents were recruited at the doorstep from a couple of doorstep callers. And that went on for 19 years. I suffered abuse from my father and one of the elders within our congregation, and nothing was done about it. It is my firm belief that this organisation is a paedophile paradise, because they don't do anything about allegations of child abuse. They don't phone the police, and that's why I'm bringing my petition here today.
And what do you think the benefits of a public inquiry which extended the scope to those who had suffered abuse by religious organisations in Scotland, what do you think the benefits of the public inquiry would be to the pursuit of the injustice you feel you've suffered?
I think the main benefit for is for the children, because the children within, particularly within the Jehovah's Witness community, are silenced. They're not allowed to speak up. And this little lamb here that I've got represents the little lambs of the community. And because they don't have a voice, they're silent. And that shouldn't be the case. Someone should speak up for them. And that's what I'm here to do today.
And in the endeavours that you made to have the situation that you were facing addressed, what was the response that you received?
The response I received was a judicial committee within the Jehovah's Witness organisation, where three elders had my father and myself in a room with them, and they asked me very provocative questions about what had happened, and then sent me and my younger sister home with my parents.
Was the, as far as they were concerned, as much as they were prepared to consider or pursue in relation to the matter?
That was pretty much all they did. They didn't do anything else apart from give my father a mild reproof, which was he was allowed to continue coming to the congregation, mixing with youngsters, mixing with other people. And not allowed to hold the microphone. That was one of the things he wasn't allowed to do.
And what age were you when you had sought to pursue these matters through the congregational process?
I was 16 years old.
Okay, thank you. Then we'd like to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Angela, for attending the committee today. It must be extremely difficult for you. What's your opinion on the Scottish Government views an argument that expanding the remit of the inquiry would only delay the time and length it would take, actually, to fulfil its commitments to other sexual abuse survivors?
I empathise with other abuse survivors who have been in care. My view is that there are children out there who are hidden in plain sight and they need to be heard as well. And whether that extends the inquiry or a separate inquiry is brought forward for this, then something needs to be done.
Could I ask you just on that point, would it be acceptable, because you've brought a petition forward, if a separate inquiry was actually brought forward into it?
I think so, because there's a difference between being in care and being out here with everybody else, watching us, and still being hidden.
Say thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And can I just note for the record that Angela Cousins is my constituent and we met in 2018 to discuss this. Angela, thanks for being with us this morning. I'm sorry that happened to you, and thank you for being so brave and speaking up for other people. I wonder if I can ask you about the suggestion that the Scottish Government has made that it will consider and address any future recommendations made by the current inquiry to improve the legislation, policy and practice. Do you think that recommendations that come from the current inquiry will be able to address the concerns that you have about what happened to you in the, within the religious organisation?
And unless there's mandatory reporting involved for religious leaders, then I don't think that this will be the case. The Scottish Government have put across the named persons, which is absolutely fantastic in my view. However, a Jehovah's Witness child won't speak to a named person. They are required to remain silent. And unless there is a religious leader mandated to speak to police and child protection services in instances like this, where allegations like this come forward, then these children will forever remain silent.
And can I ask you just a little bit more about that, about the mandatory reporting? I mean, that's something that we explored before. And if I'll just, this is the Scottish Government's words at the moment, not mine. They say there's not a compelling case for the introduction of mandatory reporting in Scotland, as previous evidence suggested there could be some significant unintended consequences for wider child protection issues. You've stated there the example of a child within your religious organisation or your previous religious organisation and why that would be different. Can you just expand a little bit more on that and why that would be helpful for a child in that situation?
Well, just yesterday in America, in the state of Illinois, they have mandatory reporting, and the elders who didn't report the child abuse of a six-year-old right up until the age of 18 were sentenced yesterday for a year each.
Okay, and you're saying that children within that organisation wouldn't talk to anyone out with the organisation. Is this why you feel that the mandatory?
Yep, that's exactly why I feel that this mandatory reporting should be put in place, because children within the organisation feel, or they're taught, that everybody outside the organisation are part of the devil's world. They're all controlled by the devil. The government's controlled by the devil. The police are controlled by the devil. So it's very nerve-wracking for a child to even say anything to anybody out with their own organisation. They're pretty much insular in a way, isolated from pretty much normal, everyday life.
Okay, thank you.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Angela, for your testimony and the questions so far. How disappointed are you that, you know, that the Scottish Government are not prepared to extend the inquiry? I mean, you know, the First Minister and Deputy First Minister made comments in the Chamber. And how do you feel about that situation, that they don't see the need to progress any further?
I think the First Minister is unaware of what has been going on underneath her own nose, what's been going on under everybody's noses. So, of course, I'm disappointed, but at the same time, I think education for the First Minister and other governmental officials is key here, where they are aware of my story, and not just my story, but the story of a number of children who are now adults across the world. There has been 30 documentaries in 15 different countries on this issue for the past 20 years. I think it's time the First Minister and other governmental officials were educated on this.
And, you know, you touched on there about other authorities that are perceived as not being supportive or being, you know, you mentioned the devil there. That is how people are brought up within that regime, to believe in that. But do you feel that you have been listened to by other authorities and other organisations and individuals?
After I came out, I met my partner. And it was him that told me that this is what I should do. I should go and speak to the police about what had happened to me. So, therefore, I have been supported by authorities. I've been supported by social workers within our area, and supported by health therapists as well, and education, as I'm a student at college at the moment. So...
Thank you.
As we know, the child sex abuse inquiry in England and Wales is going to look more broadly than the one here in Scotland, which is focused on care homes. They're going to look at religious organisations as well. I mean, you made reference there to 30 documentaries in 15 countries. Have you been able to meet with or speak with others who may potentially find that their own circumstances are going to be addressed in that public inquiry in England and Wales? Or is that a difficult kind of exchange to have?
I have, actually, because our group is mainly online to help survivors of abuse, to help people that come out of the organisation and feel very fragile. We have over 1,000 UK members within our Facebook group, and there's lots of support going forward every day.
Well, that's interesting. Is it possible, if the Scottish Government won't expand the remit of their inquiry, or has been suggested a separate inquiry were not to take place, is it possible that some of the themes and lessons and recommendations that will emerge through that separate inquiry could crystallise into actions that campaigners could pursue more directly with the Scottish Government here? I mean, in other words, is it possible that inquiry will lead to recommendations of which Scotland should be taking note too?
Well, the ICSA inquiry has concluded its inquiry, and they put forward their report, and I could bring that information to you if you don't already have that.
Yes. Okay. Paul Sweeney, you've been listening quietly. Do you have any questions you would like to put?
Thank you, Convener. I've just been quite taken aback by the testimony today. I think we all have. And I just wanted to sort of add in, obviously disappointing to hear the government's position on this, but whether you think that the suggestion by the Scottish Government to consider and address any future recommendations made by the inquiry to improve legislation, policy and practice would address or be sufficient to address any of the concerns raised in your petition? Or do you feel that that wouldn't come close to sort of dealing with it? Do you think there's at least some element of what the government are saying that might be helpful, or do you think there's not adequate at all?
I don't think so. If mandatory reporting is not there for religious leaders, then there's no way forward. And there has obviously been cases in, like, America, for instance, just yesterday, where they haven't reported, but it's about bringing that accountability for people to report this sort of abuse to authorities, because they're the people that know how to deal with this in a kind and empathic manner and not ask provocative questions of children.
That's very helpful, thanks. Obviously, mandatory reporting, you described that the way you were treated, almost gaslighted, was appalling. And can you maybe describe what you think mandatory reporting would look like? Like, how would that play out? What would it be like in your sort of ideal scenario?
In my ideal scenario, it would be just like what teachers currently have to do. So currently teachers have to report any allegation of child abuse to the police and social work. And I think if religious leaders have to be mandated to report as well, then that would go a long way in bringing that voice out for the little lambs.
Well, thank you very much. That's very...
You met Ruth McGuire a few years ago. I know you've met many politicians in the period since, and obviously will have raised your concerns directly with Scottish Government ministers. Everybody will have been very sympathetic, but of course you're looking for outcomes as much as anything. And am I right to say then that the key outcome I think we can take from the discussion we've had this morning is around the issue of mandatory reporting? Does that sit above or on the same level as a desire to see the current Scottish Government inquiry expand the scope of the work that it is doing, or are these equally parallel and important to you?
I think they're equally parallel and important, because it will help the Scottish Government have that education on what not just my former religious organisation, but other religious organisations. As my former religious organisation is a very high control group, I suppose there will be others as well that's hidden in plain sight.
Thank you. Well, your life has been rebuilt on, or is being rebuilt, with the support of your partner Ian, who we're very grateful to have with us here this morning as well. And obviously that's been hugely important to you. I suppose I'd just like, in concluding, to give you the opportunity to say anything further or to make any additional remarks that you would like just to us as a committee, which of course will then help us going forward. And if you have anything you'd like to read to us by way of a statement, I mean, that's equally valuable to us as well. But whatever you would like to say.
I'm going to actually speak about a quote that I learned whilst learning at college. Experience is for me the highest authority. The touchstone of validity is my own experience, No other person's ideas and none of my own ideas are as authoritative as my experience. It is to experience that I must return again and again to discover a closer approximation to truth as it is in the process of becoming me. That's by Carl Rogers, the psychologist.
And obviously, personal experience has very much been the basis of your understanding of these issues and the way in which you've sought to pursue public redress and public action to try and help others potentially and to have it tackled directly at source. Well, it's been very, very brave of you to join us this morning. I'm very grateful to you both. I know it was a long journey to get here and probably be a long journey back. We take this petition very seriously, and I know members will want to consider the evidence that we've heard in further detail. As you will be aware, we've gone back to the Scottish Government in relation to the inquiry, and I think on further reflection, having heard your evidence again this morning, we'll consider these points afresh. And I want to thank you very much for the time you've taken and for your courage in speaking with us today. Thank you very much. And I'll now suspend the meeting of the committee. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very difficult. Consideration of further continued petitions. Petition number PE 1876 to accurately record the sex of people charged or convicted of rape or attempted rape lodged by Lucy Hunter-Blackburn, Lisa McKenzie and Kath Murray. And forgive me, there have been some developments here, so I've slightly a long introduction before we consider potential ways forward. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to require Police Scotland, the Crown Office and the Scottish Court Service to accurately record the sex of people charged or convicted of rape or attempted rape. At our last consideration, the committee agreed to write to a number of bodies. We have now received responses from Police Scotland, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, the Equalities and Human Rights Commission and the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service. We also have an additional submission from Leslie Warrender and a further response from the petitioner. Since issuing our papers, we've received a further submission from Michelle Thompson, MSP, that was published and circulated to members yesterday. Unfortunately, Michelle cannot join us as she is participating elsewhere in Parliament this morning. In our submission, Michelle Thompson highlights concerns about the failure to consider the experience of victims in the responses received so far by the committee. She also highlights an evidence gap in qualitative research on the impact of the approach to recording the sex of perpetrators on those who have suffered from rape or sexual abuse or violence. Police Scotland state that under current operational recording practice, sex and gender are used interchangeably and identification is recorded based on how individuals present. However, they indicate that there are circumstances where the issue of biological sex may require to be explored for a legitimate policing purpose, for example, sexual offences. Their submission also states that in considering a crime, it is relevant if the perpetrator is legally defined as or self-identifies as male or female. It is only relevant that they have a penis, including a surgically constructed penis, which has penetrated one of the defined bodily orifices. Their submission sets out specific circumstances where a woman may be recorded on police systems as having committed contraventions of Sections 1 and 18 of the Sexual Offences Scotland Act 2009. In concluding, Police Scotland state that their Data Governance Board has been instructed to review their internal policies and recording procedures. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service advise that information used in criminal proceedings originates from Police Scotland. Therefore, it is a matter for Police Scotland to record the data. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service indicate that information relating to sex is not displayed in court papers. The Equality and Human Rights Commission state that any public body collecting data, including Police Scotland, should have a clear and transparent policy relating to the data they collect and the use they put it to, and that policy should be equality impact assessed. Collection of data must be necessary and proportionate. That means where a body carries out a number of functions, the data collected and the way it is collected will vary depending on the intended purpose. So, for example, Police Scotland may collect information on the protected characteristics of those to whom they are providing a service or who are the victims of crime differently from those charged with serious offences. The Commission also state how best to record data on the sex of people charged or convicted of rape or attempted rape will depend on how this data is to be used, and it is important that this is clearly defined and stated. The Commission considers the Chief Statistician's recently produced guidance on data collection and publication provides helpful information on an appropriate balance to be struck in relation to the recording of data of those charged with or convicted of rape or attempted rape. Now, the petitioner has responded to Police Scotland's submission and highlights two recent rulings in the inner house of the Court of Session. The petitioner considers these rulings place a duty on Police Scotland to collect data on biological sex in relation to people charged of rape or attempted rape. The issues of messaging to victims of sexual offending, the experience of those victims, and the need to put them at the centre of consideration is also highlighted by the petitioner and included in the submission by Leslie Warrender. The petitioner has also submitted a further response, and this was circulated to members yesterday, and it references the submission from the Commission and the guidance of the Chief Statistician. So apologies, that's quite a comprehensive package of updates that we've received, and I wonder, on reflection, having read these responses, whether members have any thoughts. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. And helpfully, I think what you've informed the committee of there actually covers probably the main points I was going to make. So if I just, in summary, think there are two aspects to this that are important and two reasons why we should keep the petition open. The first is around data. Obviously, public bodies have a duty to collect and use data appropriately. But the second, I think, is highlighted in Leslie Warrender's submission and the submission from her colleague Michelle Thompson, MSP, and that is about the centering of victims. I think sometimes when we talk about data in these matters, it can all be a bit cold. At the centre of this issue are women who have been raped, and the consequences of some of the practices that are being spoken about here are frankly devastating for the victims of that particular crime. Can I suggest that the committee asks the Scottish Government for its considerations of the recent rulings of the Inner House of the Court of Session, what implications they have for the recording practice of Police Scotland, the Crown Office, and the Scottish Court Service in relation to people charged or convicted of rape and attempted rape. The petitioner considers that the recent rulings of the Inner House of the Court of Session place a duty on Police Scotland to collect data on biological sex in relation to the people charged of rape or attempted rape. Can we ask the Scottish Government for their position on that? And also if the draft guidance on collecting data on sex and gender has been updated or finalised since it was published in December 2020, and if there are plans to consider the potential need for further revision of the guidance following these recent rulings. I would like us to also contact Police Scotland, the Crown Office and the Scottish Court Service. As you stated in your opening, we need to be clear if they have a clear and transparent policy relating to the data they collect and the use they put it to. And importantly, has that policy been a quality impact assessed? And is the quality impact assessment a public document? And if they have a defined and clear statement of how data is collected in relation to the sex of people charged or convicted of rape or attempted rape and how it's used.
Thank you very much, Ruth Maguire. I mean, that's a very comprehensive series of recommendations. I'm certainly happy to endorse. I wonder if the committee are. Is there any other member of the committee who would like to comment or add any further recommendations? No, so we consent to proceed on that basis. We keep the petition open and we write as suggested there by Ruth Maguire to the various bodies concerned. Thank you very much. Let's make sure I'm in the right place. Petition number 1884 to make whole plant cannabis oil available on the NHS or alternative funding put in place, lodged by Steve Gillen. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make whole plant cannabis oil available on the NHS or provide funds for private access for severely epileptic children and adults where all other NHS epileptic drugs have failed to help. When we last considered the petition, we agreed to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care to seek information about the progress of clinical trials and further information on his discussions with the UK government. The Cabinet Secretary's response states that he thinks the lack of evidence on the quality, safety and efficacy of CBPMs is the main barrier to them being prescribed by NHS clinicians. And he stresses the importance of the development of the trials. He outlines plans to undertake two randomised and controlled trials into early onset epilepsy. The trials will compare medicines that contain CBD only and CBD and THC with placebos. This is to help answer the question of whether adding THC to the CBD improves anti-epileptic properties. He also indicates that commercial discussions about the supply of products to the trial are underway, and further details of the trials, including the timetable, will be dependent on the conclusion of those discussions. He stated that a meeting was scheduled in early February with the UK Minister for Patient Safety and Primary Care, Maria Caulfield MP,
And this was to include a suggestion, a consideration of ways in which the trials can be expedited. The committee also requested information on existing evidence in other countries from SPICE. The review is included in your papers packet, Annex D, and provides information on current guidelines from Australia, America, Ireland and from Canada. It highlights that a review on medicinal cannabis in Australia was examined by the UK government. The UK government stated that the review showed limited but high-quality evidence for the use of medicinal cannabis products to treat epilepsy. The use and efficacy of THC treatments is addressed in the guidance for Australia, Ireland and Canada. It indicates that the evidence base for THC is complex in that it may either have either pro- or anti-epileptic properties. Much of the guidance in other jurisdictions acknowledges that there is limited evidence for the use of cannabis-based products for medicinal use and frequently advises that products should be prescribed as an add-on treatment with existing anti-epileptic drugs. The petitioner points to three existing prescriptions across the UK and reiterates that he does not accept that there is a lack of evidence for prescribing. He explains that the prescriptions have been in place for 3 years and he considers this an example of reliable evidence for the NHS. Again, sorry, quite a long introduction, and I wonder if colleagues have any comments they might wish to add. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. In light of the meeting with Patient Safety and Primary Care, Marie Caulfield, MP, in February, I wonder if we could write to the government, the Cabinet Secretary, asking for an update on how that went. And can we ask Cabinet Secretary when commercial discussions about the supply of our products to trials are likely to conclude? And if the trials will include patients, including children with severe epileptic conditions? And how patients in Scotland will be recruited for the trials? And for further information on potential timescales of trials and how these can be expedited and depending on the outcome of the potential timescales in seeking the achievement of authorisation.
Thank you. Again, that's quite a comprehensive series of recommendations. Would anybody like to add to that? Are the committee content to support? Paul Sweeney.
I think it's also important to raise that people are self-medicating using THCs already from unofficial sources that they have got supply from. So I think it might also be worth engaging with the Minister for Drugs, Angela Constance, regarding the pattern of illicit access, if you like, to substances that are of a cannabis-derived product. And also, that might illustrate, you know, where health and social care partnerships have introduced programmes such as heroin-assisted treatment, where it's actually seen as a public health benefit, where people are medicating themselves. It's much more satisfactory to be doing that in a controlled environment. Perhaps there's an angle where it's not simply about prescribing through a general practitioner or from a clinician in that context. It can also be where instances where people are already self-medicating, there's a public health interest in ensuring the harms are reduced there.
Thank you. Are members content to add those recommendations to our actions? Thank you very much. Petition number 1889, financial support for self-employed people in the travel industry. This is a continuing petition again, lodged by Nikki Peachey, and calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide tailored financial support to self-employed individuals working in the travel industry whose businesses have been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. We've received a submission from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy who explains that on the 10th of February, the Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise met with the Scottish Passenger Agents Association and ABTA to hear directly the challenges facing the outbound travel sector. The Cabinet Secretary also confirms that she has written to the UK Minister for Business and Industry on the issues raised in this petition, but has not received a response. In her submission, the Cabinet Secretary sets out details of support packages that have been made available by the Scottish Government to those affected by the COVID-19 pandemic in the travel sector. And this includes further funding for tourism businesses impacted most by the Omicron public health advice and a top-up scheme to provide additional funding to the Scotland inbound tour operators. We are advised that officials are working with stakeholders to set up a sector-specific scheme to target funds to those most impacted. including self-employed individuals that do not have premises. The submission indicates that details of eligibility and how and when to apply will be published on the Scottish Government website and on the Find Business Support website as soon as they are available. In the light of that, do members have any options considered? Alexander Stewart.
In all of that, Convener, I think that it is probably time to maybe close the petition at this stage, because a lot of work has already been done, as you've just gone into, by the Scottish Government. But I think it would be useful in closing the petition under Rule 15.7 that we do write to the Scottish Government to ask for the timescales of when they expect a new sector-specific scheme will become available, and when details of that do become available, how to apply will be published, and how the scheme will be publicised to ensure that individuals in that sector who are self-employed will have the opportunity to ensure that they are supported and they will be given the means that they have been requesting for some time.
Thank you. Any other members of the committee wish to add anything, or are we content to proceed on the recommendation of Alexander Stewart? Thank you. Well, we will close the petition. We thank the petitioners for raising it with us. We will, as I say, in doing so, write to the Scottish Government just to get the timeline in relation to the items they have agreed to pursue. Petition number 1893 to introduce legislation to protect Scotland's war memorials, lodged by James Watson on behalf of Friends of Deniston War Memorial, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce legislation which recognises desecration or vandalism of war memorials as a specific criminal offence. When we last considered this, the committee agreed to write to the Commonwealth War Graves Commission, and we have received a submission from them. However, in their detailed submission, they eventually make clear that they don't believe they have the authority to consider action in respect of this petition, as it falls outside of the scope of the war memorials directly within their responsibility. Members may recall the Scottish Government's previous submission stating that as legislation is currently in place to deal with vandalism, desecration of statues and memorials, including war memorials, the Scottish Government believed that because that legislation is already in place, they are content and have no current plans to introduce additional legislation for that specific purpose. So I think, given what we've heard from the Commonwealth War Graves Association and from, again, the Scottish Government, do colleagues have any recommended route that we might pursue? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Considering that the Scottish Government have no plans to bring in new legislation, and they feel that the legislation there to deal with any vandalism, decoration of war memorials is sufficient, I would like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Colleagues, are we content to pursue? Well, again, we'd like to thank Mr. Watson and the Friends of Deniston War Memorial. I wonder, in closing the petition, whether we could draw their attention to the specific legislation that the government believes is actually appropriate, so that they know that they have recourse within that. Petition number 1900 to prescribe access to prescribed medication for detainees in police custody, lodged by Kevin John Lawson. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all detainees in police custody can access their prescribed medication, including methadone, in line with existing relevant operational procedures and guidance. At the last consideration, we agreed to write to relevant drug treatment charities, and a coordinated response has in fact now been received from the new chair of the Scottish Drugs Deaths Task Force. But before I come to that submission, I'd also like to highlight additional correspondence received from the Scottish Government this week. And this relates to earlier questions from the committee on a register of prescribed medicines in police custody. Colleagues will recall that as part of our own investigation and consideration, it was being identified to us that the information wasn't being collected, and that in the absence of the information being collected, we weren't terribly sure or persuaded that it was possible to accurately assert that there were no issues therefore arising. The Scottish Government confirmed again that there is no central monitoring of the provision of prescribed medication in custody, and that that is therefore not something they are currently able to collate. And as a consequence of our pursuit of this matter, the government has confirmed that there is in fact an evidence gap. And as a result, the Scottish Government will consult with stakeholders in justice and health to establish the best method of addressing this gap. The Scottish Government will then report to the committee when an appropriate information gathering process has been put in place. And the clerks have brought the fact of this development to the petitioner. Turning now to the DDT submission, it confirms that its position is that all relevant individuals, including detainees in police custody, should have access to prescribed medication. This includes opiate substitution therapy, such as methadone, as contained in the guidance for Police Scotland and healthcare professionals. Their submission references police standard operating procedures, which make provision for providing access to methadone in custody. Only NHS healthcare staff can administer methadone, but police staff can administer other medications. The DDT suggests that the committee may find it helpful to learn more about the availability of healthcare staff to administer methadone in police custody. They explain that there may be some areas where healthcare staff have a significant geographical area to cover, which could impact their availability to administer methadone, resulting in some people going through withdrawal in custody. The submission also explains that the implementation of medication-assisted standards, MAT, in Scotland will enable consistent delivery of safe, accessible, high-quality drug treatment across Scotland. That includes all detainees in police custody accessing their prescribed medication, including methadone. The Scottish Drugs Death Task Force notes that the Minister for Drugs Policy made a commitment in the Scottish Parliament to embed these evidence-based medication-assisted standards by April 22. They consider active participation from people with experience of problematic drug use will be central to this. The DDT state that a demonstrable commitment from senior leaders in NHS boards, local authorities and health and social care partnerships will be critical to successful implementation. And they consider this needs to be supported by sustained funding, workforce development, system change and culture change. And the submission also states that a key way to measure success will be the experiences of people and families that use services. The negative impacts of the COVID pandemic and service delivery on initiatives to improve referrals and early access to treatment and support for those in the justice system are also highlighted. The submission states that some rural areas have raised concerns about their ability to meet same-day treatment standards. And in his submission, the petitioner continues to highlight concerns, particularly with NHS Grampian, that detainees are being prescribed an unlicensed drug, dihydrocodone, rather than prescribed methadone. The petitioner wants recognition that detainees in police custody have the right to informed consent, should be seen by an advanced nurse practitioner or doctor, and should have access to phone advice and visits as required and as per previous agreements. The petitioner calls on the Scottish Government to recognise the Mandela rules as a mandatory requirement for the treatment of detainees and ends his submission with the following quote from Mr. Mandela. It is said that no one truly knows a nation until one has been inside its jails. A nation should not be judged by how it treats its highest citizens, but its lowest ones. And I thank again the petitioner for all that he has done in highlighting and bringing this issue to the committee. And again, seek the advice of colleagues on actions we might now consider taking.
Bruce McGuire.
Thank you.
Round the table there. Convener, I think this is a really, really important matter, and I think we definitely need to take some more evidence on it. I think the issue about availability of healthcare practitioners is important. I think we also probably want an update on the commitment to embed medication-assisted standards. I wonder if colleagues would wish to hear from the chair of the Scottish Drugs Death Task Force, perhaps, and also actually the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. I think I would agree with the petitioner that the rights of those detained by the state are important, and certainly in terms of healthcare, it seems like there's a bit of a gap here that we need to explore.
Are members content with those suggestions? David Torrens.
Convener, I was just going to agree with my colleague, Ruth Maguire. I'd really like to hear from the Chair of the Scottish Drugs Death Task Force and the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans.
Can I suggest that in doing so, we schedule that for after the summer recess, by which time the government ought by then to have had an opportunity to consider what this reporting information process might look like and give us some indication as to when that would be in place and operational. And it will also allow us just to see what progress has been made in relation to some of the other deadlines that were referred to in the various submissions that we received. Thank you. I'm sorry, because Mr. Sweeney is online, I unfortunately didn't notice him trying to catch my eye on petition 1893, which was introducing legislation to protect Scotland's war memorials. Sorry, Mr. Sweeney, is there anything you would like to add? Just, I'm quite happy to keep to revisit our decision in the light of anything you might want to say.
Okay, it was merely, I'm not particularly bothered about maintaining it open. What another angle that might be worth considering is actually writing to Historic Environment Scotland to ask them to study and potentially consider war memorials for listing as a statutory listing, so that would give them a degree of protection in planning law. That was the only angle that I thought might be worth considering.
Thank you. I think we could combine that recommendation with the still with the closure of the petition, but we could, in doing so, write with that suggestion, if that is if you're content with that.
Yeah, that's fine. No problem.
We're content with that, colleagues. Yeah. Petition number 1901 to replace the voting system for the Scottish Parliament with a more proportional alternative. The next continued petition is PE 1901. It's lodged by Richard Wood. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to replace the broadly proportional additional member system used for electing MSPs with a more proportional alternative. Our last meeting, we agreed to write to the Electoral Commission. It holds no views in their response. By way of a reminder, the petition states that the additional member system is not fully proportional. The Scottish Government, I think, have indicated that they have got no ambition to review the system at the present time. And given that those are the position, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Commissioner. Yes, as you've indicated, the Scottish Government have come back and said that it is not their intention to change the voting system for MSPs within the Scottish Parliament. So I'm not aware that we can take any further action on this. So in reality, we thank the petitioner, and under Rule 15.7 Standing Orders, we would have to close the petition at this stage because there's no further action that we can actually take.
Any colleagues wish to comment? Mr. Sweeney, are you trying to come in?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm just curious, is it the gift of the government to change the electoral system? Surely it's a parliamentary decision. So is it not something that is a matter for the Parliamentary Bureau to consider a review of the Parliament's electoral system rather than being the government?
I'm not actually sure that it is. I think it is actually the government that brings forward... I mean, it would be for the government to initiate an inquiry, if it so chose, into any change to the electoral system for any form of representation to which this parliament, so for local government, for example. But it would then be on the basis of any consultation or convention or whatever, it would be for the government of the day to bring forward any proposals to change the system. So it would require government legislation. Ruth McGuire?
I suppose, on Paul's point, a member could bring forward legislation, but it would need to be legislation that's brought forward. And given that it's not in anyone's manifesto and the current government are not intending to change it, I think it should close.
Yeah. So, no, I'm not certainly aware of any committee that is considering bringing forward a parliamentary bill or anything like that. So, I'm not quite sure.
So I'm sympathetic to the petitioner's request because I think the additional member system's rubbish, but there we go.
Yes. Well, yeah,
I'm not, but I don't think that assists us. That cogent summation of the merits of the current system, I'm not sure advances the committee this morning in terms of recourse us, so far as the petition itself is concerned. I'm minded to accept Alexander Stewart's suggestion that we close the petition at this time. We're agreed. Yes, fine. Petition 1907, to provide funded early learning and childcare for all two-year-olds in Scotland, lodged by Claire Beats. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide funded early learning and childcare for all two-year-olds, removing the eligibility criteria for access to services. And submissions have now been received from COSLA, the National Day Nurseries Association, and the petitioner, as we requested. The COSLA submission references the delay in the implementation of additional funded early learning hours resulting from the pandemic and the work to increase capacity in early learning centre settings. They welcome the increased uptake of places for two-year-olds, but recognise further work is needed to fully engage with the families of eligible children. COSLA stressed the importance of taking a planned and considered approach to the creation of additional capacity. The MDNA submission explains it as the national charity representing private, voluntary and independent children's nurses across the UK. They state that expanded funding for all two-year-olds would benefit children and families, and they reference recent survey findings showing significant impacts on babies born during the lockdowns. The NDNA referenced the role of early learning in providing wide-ranging opportunities for children to develop their skills and knowledge through activities and interactions. However, they also highlight concerns over the implications for the PVI sector of increasing the funding offered to all two-year-olds. They reference recent recruitment difficulties and the impact of underfunding on the sustainability of nurseries and the viability of children's places, and state that any universal funded provision for two-year-olds must be sufficiently funded at rates that reflect the cost of delivery. This is very much something that local nurseries have raised with me. In her submission, the petitioner states that as a nursery practitioner and a mother to a baby born in 2020, she sees the challenges arising from babies born in lockdown having little to no socialisation outside of their home as babies' closed groups were closed. And the petitioner believes babies born during lockdown should have the same access to funded learning and childcare regardless of their parents' financial situation, adding that research suggests lockdown babies are not at the same developmental levels as non-lockdown babies. Interesting. Colleagues, having considered the representations that we have received, I think there are a number of potential actions that we might want to consider taking forward. Would anybody like to offer some suggestions? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I think we should keep the petition open and write to Scottish Government to ask when it intends to implement its commitment to expand its early learning offer to all 1 and 2 year olds, for its views on the recent submissions received for this petition, and particularly views and concerns regarding the impact of the pandemic has had on the development of babies born during lockdown, what plans it takes to address this.
Are we all happy with that? So we'll take forward, I think, on the basis of what we've heard, the suggestions as detailed there by David Torrens. So the petition remains open and we'll see what further responses we receive. That was the last of our continuing petitions. We have a couple of new petitions to consider. Petition number 1918 to improve sex education in schools. This is a petition lodged by Kate Friedman. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reform sex education by updating guidance and implementing clear teaching rules focusing on topics such as menstruation-related illnesses, puberty, LGBT sex, including asexuality, fertility, pornography, and any other things that are deemed useful. The petitioner conducted a survey of 150 students in their school and found that most people rated their period education at 1 to 3 out of 10. The petitioner references a general lack of knowledge of many young people surrounding sex and shares their own experience as a student. They felt that school sex education was lacking and subsequently sought more detailed information on YouTube. The Scottish Government response to the petition outlines the existing resources for relationship, sexual health and parenthood learning hosted on a central website which was developed and published by a collaborative partnership of health boards and local authorities.
The resource includes learning activities and information on the topics raised by the petitioner. The Scottish Government state that the curriculum is not mandatory and it is up to teachers to decide which resources they deliver. It also indicates that it is committed to updating the current RSHP teaching guidance and issuing this for public consultation in the new year. The SPICE briefing provides background on the current statutory guidance and indicates that the Scottish Government has been reviewing this over recent years. At the time of writing, neither the new guidance nor draft guidance had been published. I can only say that some years since I was at school and there was nothing very much offered to us, but that of course is not contemporary, but I have actually just drawn this petition to the attention of a number of younger people who have all more recently supposedly been there to benefit from current information and practice, and they all universally said it was absolutely rubbish, was the without really any so I mean I have to say very much supported the view of the petitioner in relation to the quality of the education, although weren't terribly sure that they would have wanted it to be any better either. So I'm kind of slightly at odds. But I mean, I think clearly at this stage, I think we would want to take some further actions in terms of clarification of the submissions we've received. Any suggestions from the committee or comments colleagues would like to make? Ruth McGuire?
Convener, I suppose one reflection I would have is that, and this is from being on the Education Committee, that quite often there are calls for very specific things to be taught, and that's not how our system works, and I guess on this topic as well, that it's on relationships and sexual health. That's not something for just teachers to tell children about. That's for a whole community job, if you like, or families, and not community, perhaps family. Can I suggest that we write to Education Scotland and ask them how they're monitoring the implementation of the current teaching resources? And perhaps we want to also hear from the Scottish Government on how the views of children and young people are included and how they're going to influence policy in this regard. We probably want to know as well when the public consultation will be open and how that will be promoted to children and young people, and when it anticipates the revised guidance to be in place. I seem to recall the Education Committee doing something on this quite recently. It might not be that recently, but perhaps can we find out if so that we're not... I know that colleagues might wish to reach out to stakeholders as well, but I'd be keen to not double work, so we should maybe check if, you know, what's been happening in other areas as well.
Yeah, but I'm happy to... Are we content to pursue it on that basis? And I very much take your point in relation to calls for specific areas, and I mean I think what's important is that would be thought to be useful by those to whom it would ultimately be aimed at, and that I think is perhaps where part of the issue rests, that they don't. Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
Could I suggest them also writing to each of the local authorities to get an assessment of what their current provision is? It might be helpful to get an understanding of how each local authority manages it in their schools. It might be helpful in terms of sex education provision. Some schools will have teachers that are specially trained. Others might have a team that go around different schools. You know, it might be interesting to see what each local authority is doing, and that might help to inform the petitioner.
Ruth McGuire?
This is not in any way disagreeing with my colleague Paul Sweeney, but I wonder can we be thoughtful about how we do this? I'm conscious that we don't just want to generate lots and lots of correspondence. Perhaps we can do a bit of desktop research to see, you know, what the differences might be in terms of guidance rather than letters.
I think Ruth McGuire's suggestion that we just check with the Education Committee to see whether and when this might most recently have been considered is useful. And then there might be some further information already available that we can obtain in relation to local authorities. I mean, I can remember this coming up at hustings and schools as well, actually, in terms of it falls within, I can't remember what the acronym is it? Is it PHSA or P? Sorry, I can't remember. It's not this one, it's something else. But anyhow, but yes, can we reserve the opportunity to do that if we find that we haven't got the further information required? Petition 1922, cancel all local authority expenditure on Gaelic expansion. Which is the final new petition today from Douglas Capon, and it urges the Scottish Government to abandon the expansion of Gaelic in, I think, Ruth Maguire, you said Gaelic.
Gaelic, yes.
In Gaelic Week or something.
Shach in the Gaelic, Gaelic Week.
The petitioner considers that there is no demand for Gaelic in the Central Belt, funds are limited and should be spent wisely, and there is no evidence of Gaelic being the national language in Scotland. National in inverted commas there. The petitioner considers that money should not be spent on dual language road and rail signs, documents and website translations and local authority employee language education, as there is no economic benefit in this. The Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills response to the committee states that the Gaelic language has been spoken throughout Scotland for many centuries. The Scottish Government submission states that Gaelic Scotland Act 2005, to encourage and enable more people to use Gaelic, was passed in the Parliament with unanimous cross-party support. In addressing the petitioner's concerns regarding signage, the Cabinet Secretary states that the Education Scotland Act 2016 places a duty on all local authorities across Scotland to promote Gaelic education, and there is growth and demand for Gaelic medium education in the Central Belt. The Scottish Government advises that standard practice is that Gaelic signage is created as part of a replacement or renewal process to keep these costs to a minimum. There is an implementation fund which is open to bids from any public authority to help meet any project costs or development associated with their Gaelic language plan, including activities such as signage or staff training. The petitioner's response to the Scottish Government submission suggests that, in his view, there is confusion between demand for Gaelic and demand for smaller class sizes. He also points out that figures on how much is being spent have not been provided. Bord na Gaelic also submit a response to the petition outlining the demand for Gaelic medium education. It highlights 2011 census data illustrating that Central Belt local authorities accounted for 30% of those living in Scotland with some skills in Gaelic. The submission also details examples of economic benefits and research to support this position. The Scottish Government's budget 22-23 sets out its funding to support Gaelic, and the Scottish Government has stated it is committed to increasing the numbers using and learning Gaelic, it will maintain its support for Gaelic education, arts and broadcasting, and it plans to introduce a languages bill in the current parliamentary session. One point that occurs to me in that is that I don't know what 30% of those living in Scotland with some skills in Gaelic actually means, because it doesn't tell me what how many people that represents, you know, with the Central Belt local authorities say. However, colleagues, do we have a series of recommendations that we would like to consider? And I'm very happy to hear from Ruth Maguire.
Morning, Tang. Thank you, convener. I think that we've been given clear evidence here on Gaelic and its use in Scotland. The Gaelic language has been spoken throughout Scotland for many, many, many centuries. It's not the only language of Scotland, but it's one of Scotland's languages, and it deserves and should command equal respect to the other languages of our nation. There are a number of economic benefits, as has been stated. I think the petitioners claim that there's no evidence for a desire for support for the Gaelic language throughout Scotland isn't backed up by evidence, and certainly in my own constituency in Ayrshire, there is a Gaelic medium primary school now. These calls for education are parent-led. They don't come from the government, they come from parents. Every party in the Parliament is committed to Gaelic and supports education, arts and broadcasting. And as you said in opening there, there is plans for a languages bill in the coming session. For all these reasons, I would propose that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
OK, thank you. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Like my colleague Ruth McGuire says, minority groups or cultures and their languages should be protected in Scotland. And it's not only Gaelic it's spoken. You could look at Doric and other languages that's spoken across Scotland. And they should be encouraged and given the resources to thrive. And as somebody who comes from a Central Belt constituency, I know a number of my constituents go to Gaelic classes, so I'm fully supportive of closing the petition under 15.7 of standing orders.
Any other colleagues wish to come in? No? Sorry, I have just had an answer to my earlier question. Is that there are 87,000 people living in Scotland with some skills in Gaelic, so if Central Belt represents 30% of them, that would be 26,100 people across the Central Belt of Scotland, which I think they said between a significant number of local authorities. However, we've got a recommendation before us. Are we content to proceed on the basis of the recommendation by Ruth McGuire and supported by David Torrens? We are. We thank Mr. Cavan for his petition, but given the government's commitment to Gaelic education, we are unable to take the petition further forward and will close it. That concludes our meeting in public this morning. We next meet on the 20th of April after the Easter recess, and we move into private session.